your church, and it will be conducted by not only our minister director, but he is a pastor, Pastor Stephen Jenks. He came here last Sabbath and presented his message, so we encourage you all to come. Please invite your friends outside and outside the church, neighbors, co-workers to attend. Times would be from 7 to 8 p.m. on Fridays and 11 a.m. on Saturdays. So please come for that. Today also, I want to remind you, I think I forgot to say this, that there is an elders meeting right after worship at room 104 in the daycare building. If you would like to get involved in nursing home visits, the dates are there. Please contact Pastor John for further information. That is the end of our announcements. We want to thank you all for coming, and may you be blessed today.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. It's time for the children's story. May I ask all the parents to walk with their children with them? Come here. The children, where are the children? Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Yes. All right. I'm glad to see you all today. Yes. We have all this kid. All right. Our story today is about the man who walked into heaven. Wow, who do you think this man was? The man who walked into heaven. Anyone? There are two men in the Bible who were mentioned that walked with God. Elijah is one, that's right. And there's... And who's the other one? It starts with letter E. Elijah. It's Enoch. Correct. Yes. Knew it. Okay. So, when Enoch was a little boy, he liked to listen to stories. Who among you here like to listen to stories? Like bedtime stories, yes? Okay, that's good. So, Enoch was the great, 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 great grandson of Adam and Eve. He was in the seventh generation. So, he liked to listen to stories. So, one day, Adam and Eve told a story to Enoch about Garden of Eden, how they walked with God, how they looked at the Garden of Eden, and it was really nice. So, they were so glad to listen. And Enoch wished that one day he could also walk with God. Who wished and who prayed here that you can also walk and talk to God? Anyone? Oh, that's great. Yes, how do we talk to God? Do you talk to God when you are happy? Yes. Do you talk to God when you are sad? Yes, when you are crying, you talk to God. When you are happy and you are excited, when you play, yes, God is very pleased if you talk to Him like His best friend. So now when Enoch was already big and a man, he got married. He was like 62 years old when he got married, and he had a little boy named Methuselah. So every time they walked, so the boy and the dad, the Enoch, they walk, and they always, Methuselah always see his dad looking and talking to God always, and they walk, and then Enoch, his dad, can always see the angel with the sword in the Garden of Eden, and he liked to talk. So, when we talk and we walk with God, we have in Micah 6:8, it says that we have, He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? So when we walk with God, it says to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. So little boys and girls, when you walk at the park with your dad or your mom, you listen to your mom and dad, right? Yes, you listen, you talk to them. Okay, what they're saying, you focus what they're saying. It's the same with walking with God. So we have to focus, we have to think of God, knowing God. We have to hear His voice, showing our hearts or sharing our hearts with Him and making God happy. Who likes to make God happy? Raise your hand. Yes, we have to make God happy. How can we make God happy? Okay, let me ask. How can we make God happy? One at a time.
Praying.
Praying?
Yeah. Reading the Bible.
Reading the Bible?
Worship.
Worship, that's right. How can we make God happy?
Worship.
Worship, yes. How can we make God happy? Who else?
How can we make God happy?
Listening to parents, singing. Yes?
Read Bible.
Oh, read the Bible, that's good. So when Enoch was then walking with God, and when he was already like a man, and Enoch walked with God, and he just disappeared, and they know, because every day they can see the light in his face. When you walk and talk with God always, and you please God, your face shines differently, right? Because God is helping you, and the light is shining towards you. So I hope everyone will walk with God and talk with God, pray always, and read the Bible, listen to your parents, and I hope you will also one day see God in heaven, just like every one of us wanted to do. So who would like to pray? Oh, Sophia, okay. Oh, who would like to pray? Okay, please, everybody, close your eyes.
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you that we had a good night rest. Peace on your way, angels to watch over us as we learn more about you as we're here in church. And please help us to walk with you. And please forgive our sins for what we've done. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you. Please get your buckets. Slowly, and let's collect our offerings. Thank you.
Let us all stand for our call to worship. Nehemiah wrote in Nehemiah 9:6, I praise you, God, because you alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens, and all their starry host, the earth and all that is in it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you. Our worship will be and always be for our God in heaven. This Sabbath, our call to worship is for Christ alone. Amen.
Father God, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for getting us through this week. Whatever trials or situations have come our way, we thank you and we praise you that we're able to be here. We invite your Holy Spirit here today. Please open our hearts, open our minds, and open our ears to whatever message that you have for us today. We love you and we can't wait to see you. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Philippians 4:19 says, "And my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus." Today's offerings are for the Elementary Education Endowment. May we always remember to not only give your tithes, but your offerings as well. Let us give freely with our hearts, and let's remember to not worry about what will happen tomorrow, for our God will meet all our needs. May the deaconesses please stand. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us here today and for giving us another day of life. Please help us to continue to give with a cheerful heart and to be more like you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Now is the time for us to lift our voices in praises to the Lord. We have a lot of testimonies that has come as we have gone through this week. Some were sad, some were joyous. But both of them are just all testimonies of the goodness of Christ in our lives. So let's just do just as that this morning. Let us raise our voices in praise of Him as we sing, "Give Me Jesus and Wonderful Merciful Savior."
Almighty, infinite. That would like to give it to the Lord, come. Any joys in the heart that you like, praise to the Lord, please come. Let us all come down, give all God the glory and honor, because He alone deserves it.
What our hearts long for.
What a blessing just to be here in your church right now, Lord God. Our hearts are filled with joy, filled with praise, that despite of the challenges we have throughout the week, you have proven, oh God, you are the one true God. In the battle of Mount Carmel, you have proven to the people around, oh God, you're the only one deserving. You're the only one, God, that serves praise and honor and glory. Lord God, your people right now, Lord, kneeling down before you, accept us, oh God. Please, Lord, cleanse our impurities, oh God, through the blood of Jesus Christ who died for us. Empty us, oh God, from any pride, from any selfishness, self-righteousness. Let all of us, oh God, right now, just truly experience your presence, oh Lord, hovering us over right now, Lord God. Empty us, oh Lord, and let you speak to us, each one of us right now, to our hearts and our minds, oh Lord God. And we claim Philippians 4:4-7, Lord God. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Be kind. Let your gentleness be made known to all men. Be anxious to nothing, but by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And Lord, because of this, and we believe that you're the only one who could give us peace. In verse 7, you said, and let the peace of God that passeth understanding will guard our minds and our hearts. And through it all, we have victory in our hands, because we claim this only in you, Lord God. We can have this victory. Lord, hear your people affront, O God. We have so many burdens. It could be financial issues, health issues, O Lord God, or disagreements in the family. Lord God, mend every broken relationships. Take good care of our finances, O Lord. Take good care of our jobs. O Lord God, we need you more than ever before. We cannot live, O Lord God, day by day, just always depending on ourselves. Change our mindset, O God, to the mindset of Christ. May the character, the personality of heaven be upon us, O Lord, that we become more of to others, observing others than to ourselves. Help us not to be selfish, O Lord God, but just to proclaim your gospel in spirit and in truth, in the way we speak and the way we handle the matter, O God. May the gentleness of heaven be upon us, O Lord. When someone cuts us while driving, O Lord God, let us not be upset, just little things. Please, Lord, have mercy upon us. We're so far away from the righteousness that you set for your children, higher than human thoughts could think about. Oh Lord God, is your standard for your children. Oh Lord God, help us. Drill amongst us, oh Lord God, that we may truly experience, oh Lord, life-changing experience in you, Lord God. So many plans in this church, but what is planning without you? So Lord, may you bless all our plans, all the ministries in this church, and the upcoming Pastor Jing's revival meeting, oh Lord, I pray. We pray, Lord God, and we plead you to please give us a burden in our hearts to reach out to those around us, our neighborhood, our co-workers, oh Lord, that they will be inspired as well, Lord God, to come in our nightly meetings, and they too will accept you as their Savior and King. Oh Lord, as we hear you through Sister Samantha, Lord God, be with her. Guide her lips, oh God, that the meditation in her heart and her mind, oh God, speaks about heaven, speaks about Christ, and that you alone is our focus today, right now, Lord God. Embrace us totally as one body of Christ. Help each other, love one another, and help us not to be conceited or proud of what we think that we have accomplished in this church, because truly it's you alone, Lord, deserve it. Thank you, God, for everything, for your love and grace that showers us every day. Thank you so very much for hearing us. In Jesus' name, amen.
One, Lord, make us one. please stand for our scripture reading? We will be reading from 2 Samuel 23, verse 8 through 12. These are the names of the mighty men whom David had: Josheph, Bashabeth, the Tachamite, chief among the captains. He was called Adino the Ezraite because he had killed 800 men at one time. He arose and attacked the Philistines until his hand was weary, and his hand stuck to the sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to plunder. But he stationed himself in the middle of the field, defended it, and killed the Philistines. So the Lord brought about a great victory. Amen. May you be blessed, and please be seated.
Hello, everyone. Happy Sabbath. It's so nice to see all of your wonderful smiling faces here today. I was joking with Pastor Jeff earlier. We were talking about how Pastor Dan, his sermons are about 45 minutes to an hour long. Pastor Jeff's sermons are about 15 minutes to 20 minutes long. So they give me a pretty good bracket, so I'm just going to go right down the middle. So everyone settle down, because for the next 2 hours, no, I'm just kidding. We won't be here for that long, but we will stay as long as it's needed in order for the word of God to be preached. Amen? All right, so join with me as we open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father God, here I am, just a servant. I ask and I beg of you that you hide me behind your cross, that it's not about me, but it's only about you. Amen. So the title of today's sermon is Ways of a Warrior. Now, I'm not talking about the basketball team. This is a different kind of team. Thank you. And I would like to start off with a question. By a show of hands, how many of you have heard of the Charge of the Light Brigade? Raise your hands. Okay, good. We have some history buffs in here. That's awesome. And for those of you that didn't raise your hand, it's all good. We're going to have a history lesson right now. So this famous battle took place during the Crimean War in 1854. Now, on one side of the war were the Russians, and on the other side were the British, France, the Kingdom of Sardinia, and the Ottoman Empire. Now, during this war, it was fought to gain control of the Ottoman Empire, and this is where the famous Charge of the Light Brigade battle took place. Now, in this battle, it consisted of 600 British soldiers, and their task was to charge into a Russian valley to gain control of the land. But what they didn't know, what the British did not know, was essentially they were Russian into a trap. You see, due to a miscommunication of orders, the British did not know that the valley was already surrounded by the enemy. Essentially, the British soldiers were charging into their death. According to history, this was one of the worst battle blunders ever. With the results, it was estimated that over 278 soldiers died. And the valley that they were trying to take over was appropriately named the Valley of Death. But even though history notes that this is one of the worst battle mistakes due to poor leadership, history notes about the bravery and the loyalty of the soldiers. You see, when they were charging into that valley, they saw the enemy. They saw the enemy was surrounding them, but it was interesting because they did not retreat. They still followed their commander, even though they knew the outcome would be the death of them. This loyalty and bravery of the soldiers inspired one man, his name was Lord Alfred Tennyson, to write one of my favorite poems, The Charge of the Light Brigade. And I have little excerpts of the poem, just some of my favorite parts. I'll read a little bit of it. It says, "Forward, the Light Brigade. Was there a man dismayed? Not though, but the soldier knew someone had blundered. Theirs not to make reply. Theirs not to reason why. Theirs but to do or die. Into the valley of death rode the 600. What can their glory fade? Oh, the wild charge that they made. All the world wondered. Honor the charge they made. Honor the Light Brigade. Honor the 600. You see, there are many more stories in our history books about battles, about soldiers, about victories, about defeats. And for me personally, I like to read these stories. I like to take these stories and figure out what I can learn from them. What I can learn from them in order to become a better person and to adopt all those positive characteristics. So, what better book to learn from than the Bible? I mean, this is one of the greatest history books I've ever read. So let's turn into it now. There you go. So the Bible, as we know, has a record of wars, of stories, stories of bravery and loyalty and valor. And we, some of these stories and people are very familiar to us. We have Joshua in the Battle of Jericho. We have Gideon and the Midianites, Samson and the Philistines, Saul and the Moabites, Jonathan and the Philistines, basically all the Steins and the Ites, we fought against them. And one of the famous battles that we know of is David and Goliath. So I want to turn a little bit towards David for now. We know that David was a great king and he had a great kingdom. But behind every king and behind every great kingdom is a great army. And that brings us to our scripture reading. So I'm going to reiterate it because I really like these verses, and I'll do my best to pronounce these names correctly, so just bear with me. These are the names of David's mighty warriors. Joseph, Basabeth, a Tekemenite, was chief of the three. He raised his spear against 800 men, whom he killed in one encounter. Next to him was Eleazar, son of Dodai the Ahohite. As one of the three mighty men, he was with David when they taunted the Philistines gathered at Pass Damim for battle. Then the Israelites retreated, but Eleazar stood his ground and struck down the Philistines, till his hand grew tired and froze to the sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day, and the troops returned to Eleazar only to strip the dead. Next to him was Shema, son of Agi, the Hararite. When the Philistines banded together at a place where there was a field full of lentils, Israel's troops fled from them. But Shema stood and took his stand in the middle of the field. He defended it and struck down the Philistines, and the Lord brought about a great victory that day. So this is jam-packed with all these victories and all these battles, and that's part of the reason why I chose these verses to be part of our talk today. So my question is, so what? We already know that David had a great kingdom. We already know that he was a great king. So what if these men did all these great things? So what if they killed 800 men? Why even mention them in the Bible? Well, family, I hope to answer these questions with you today. So let's dive on in. Our first of the mighty men is Joseph. Now, Joseph killed 800 men in one encounter with his spear. Now, church, listen carefully. Please listen. I'm not saying to go buy a spear and kill 800 men. Please do not do that. You're going to get me in trouble. Don't do it. But I think one of the lessons that we can learn from Joseph is that though he won a great physical battle, for us today, we're not fighting a physical battle. We are fighting a spiritual battle. So turn with me, if you have your Bibles or your phones, to Ephesians 6, verse 12. Ephesians 6, verse 12. And it reads, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." So we know that we are fighting a spiritual battle. It is only appropriate when we're fighting this battle to have the correct weapons. We can't fight a spiritual battle with a spear or a sword. But what we need to do is fight with spiritual weapons. And what are these weapons? Turn with me to 2 Corinthians 10, verse 4. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 4. And it reads, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." So we know the weapons that we fight with are the weapons of the spiritual realm. So we have prayer and we have the word of God. If we look at Joseph, we can infer and deduce that Joseph had to practice with his spear every day for who knows how long, for countless days, in order for him to be able to kill these 800 men. In translation to our lives, when we use our spiritual weapons, when we practice with them, it's not enough that we just use it on Saturday. It's not enough that we just use it twice a week if we go to midweek. No, we have to utilize and practice with prayer and read the word of God every day so that we can be better prepared to fight not 800 men, but 800 spiritual problems for whatever the devil is going to throw at us. So those are the lessons that we can learn from Joseph. Our next mighty warrior is Eleazar. From the verses, we can see that Eleazar stayed with David. He stayed by David's side, even though the Israelites retreated. In the same way for us today, sometimes when we start to follow God, it may feel like your friends and your family may leave you alone. And it feels like you have to face the enemy by yourself. But family, remember that we are not alone. As long as we stay by God's side, it is guaranteed that we have that victory. And we can infer from Eleazar that he was not scared when he was standing by David's side, because he knew that, man, if I have David by my side, there's nothing that I can't do. And it's the same way with us. We have to stay by God's side. And with Eleazar, we can also learn that he could not have won that victory without the use of his weapon. And what was his weapon? Yes, the sword. Guys, I want you to talk with me. I don't want to be up here by myself. So yes, he had his sword. And the verse talked about how even when Eleazar grew tired, did he drop his sword? No. In fact, he held his sword even tighter. And it is the same way with us. Though we don't have a physical sword, family, what is our sword? That's right. So turn with me in your swords to Hebrews 4, verse 12. Hebrews 4, verse 12. And it reads, "For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart." In the same way with us, we shouldn't just read the word when everything is good, when your life is great. No, we have to continue to read the word, even when we feel scared, even when we feel hopeless, even when we feel tired and we don't feel like reading it. That's all the more reason to hold your sword tighter to your hearts. So again, some lessons we've learned from Eleazar is that we can't fight the spiritual battle without our spiritual weapons, without our sword. And we can't fight this battle without staying by God's side. And moreover, Eleazar stuck to his sword. You know the term, stick to your guns? Well, this term came first, stick to your sword. So again, that's some lessons that we can learn from Eleazar. And our last of the mighty warriors is Shema. According to the verses, we see that Shema was fighting the Philistines in a field full of lentils. Some other versions say a field of barley or a field of wheat, but we'll stick with lentils for today. So why in the world would he stay and defend a field of lentils? You know, growing up in a Filipino household, my nanay always, when I was growing up, always tried to make me eat munggo. You guys know what munggo is? Munggo is lentils. And when I was growing up, I did not like vegetables. I'm sorry, nanay, I like your cooking now. But when I was younger, I did not like lentils whatsoever. So if I was a soldier and you told me, Sam, go to defend that field of munggo, I would say, no, let the enemy have it. I'm not going to eat it. But why? Why would Shema stay here? Shema was smart. He knew. He knew that if the Philistines were able to conquer this field, it would essentially cut off the Israelites' source of food. You see, if the Philistines were able to take over this field, it would cripple the Israelites, it would cripple the kingdom, and that would mean a victory for the enemy. So Shema knew this. And another thing too, Shema realized that where that field was God's promised land. And he wasn't about to let the enemy take that from him and from his people. So he stood his ground. He was faithful in his service. I guess you can say he was faithful in his field. So, what field has God put you in? What is your field of study? Is your field to be an occupational therapist, a physical therapist, a doctor, a businesswoman, an accountant? Whatever field God places you in, you must be faithful. And you have to be able to stand your ground even if you feel like what you're doing is insignificant. Can you imagine the soldiers running away from Shema and telling him, Shema, it's just a field of munggo. You don't need to protect it. It's fine. That field is insignificant. No. God called Shema to defend that field. And Shema might have been thinking at first, it's just a field. There's no meaning to it. When God calls you to do something and you don't think it's significant, think again, because it is significant. Another lesson that we can learn from Shema is that he defended the defenseless. These lentils, this field of lentils, had no way whatsoever. They had no means of protecting themselves against the Philistines. They were defenseless. But yet, God called Shema to stay in that field and protect it. If God called Shema to do that, how much more is he calling us to defend defenseless people? By defenseless people, I mean those who don't have the power or don't have the voice to speak for themselves. I'm talking about people who are oppressed and people who are seeking refuge. Should we not receive these people with open arms and not build a wall of indifference and hatred? No. There's even biblical support for this. Turn with me to Isaiah 1, verse 17. Isaiah 1, verse 17. And it reads, "Learn to do right. Seek justice. Defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless and plead the cause of the widow." Now, family, I don't know about you, but I hear on the news, I see on the news that there are so many people in this world that need Jesus. And what better way to show them Jesus than through our actions, through whatever God calls us to do? And again, more biblical references. Turn with me to Micah 6, verse 8. Micah 6, verse 8. And it reads, "He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." So these are the lessons that we can learn from Shema. Now, in case you are one of those people that like summary slides I have provided for your needs, here is a summary of what we've talked about. I like to call this slide Legs on Lessons, because this phrase means that you take what you learned today and you walk out with it. Don't just leave what you learned here in the church. Otherwise, there's no use for it. So put your legs on these lessons. So this is what we've learned from Joseph. Even though we know that he won a great spiritual battle, a great physical battle, our battle is a spiritual one. And in order for us to win that battle, in order for us to be successful in that battle, we have to be willing to use those spiritual weapons. And those spiritual weapons are prayer and the Word of God. And it's not enough to practice with those weapons once or twice a week. It's not enough to practice with those weapons when everything is good in your life. No, you have to be willing to practice with them each and every day so that you can continue to grow and continue to defeat whatever the devil will throw at you. And from Eleazar, we know that he stuck by David's side and he didn't have to fear because he knew if he was by David, he would win. And the same thing with us. We have to be willing to stick by God's side, even if it feels like we are alone. And from Eleazar, we know that he stuck to his sword. Same thing with us. We have to stick to our sword even when we feel tired, even if we don't feel like reading it. Again, that's all the more reason to hold your sword, hold the Word of God tighter. And lastly, with Shema, he was faithful in his field. In the same way with us, we have to be faithful in whatever field God has placed us in. And we have to be willing to stand up in that field and do what God calls us to do, even if it feels like it's insignificant. And with Shema, he was called by God to defend the defenseless. And that's the same way with us too. If you see a need, if you see people who are searching and yearning for something more, that is God calling you to do something. So how did these guys get to where they were? How did they end up gaining all this victory or being recorded in the Bible as one of David's greatest men? I believe there are a lot of parallels we can learn from these men, from this story, and apply it to our lives today. So if you turn with me to 1 Chronicles 11, verse 10. 1 Chronicles 11, verse 10. And it reads, "These were the chiefs of David's mighty warriors. They, together with all of Israel, gave his kingship strong support to extend it over the whole land, just as the Lord had promised." I like this verse because it tells us, it's a recount of David's mighty warriors, kind of like what we read earlier. But in this passage, the wording is a little bit different. It says that together they gave his kingship, which is David, they gave his kingship strong support. And I don't know about you, but a great kingdom means that everyone is working together. Everyone is in one accord and everyone is supporting each other. So these guys, these mighty warriors, they gave David everything that they had. I propose that these warriors, before they gained all their victories, before they did all of those things, the first thing that they had to do was they had to learn who they were fighting for. They had to figure out, okay, this King David, he seems a little bit young, but we're supposed to be serving him. Let's find out what he's all about. So they learned more about David. They looked at his values, and they took it upon themselves to reset in their heart, to align themselves with what David believed in. And that's the same way with us in our own spiritual lives. How can we fight for a God that we don't know? In the same way with us, we have to sit down and we have to learn. We have to figure out who God is, who is he to me, what are his values, and then from there, you take it upon your heart to align yourselves with his values. Once you've developed a relationship with God, and once you understand his values, then you can take the next step, which is actually taking a stand. These warriors, once they learned about who David was and they followed him wholeheartedly, when the enemy tried to take over the kingdom, they stood up for David. They stood up for David and the kingdom's values. It's the same way with us. Once we develop that relationship with God, we have to be willing to stand up for God and his values, even when it feels like we're the only ones doing it. By standing up for God's values, we feel the need to share it with the world. It's up to us to share his love and his values to those who need it, which means loving the poor, advocating for those who can't advocate for themselves. And when all is said and done, is that it? Is that it? Is that everything we need to do? No, that's right, it's not. Can you imagine if these warriors, after they gained all their victory, did they just go back into the palace and say, we're done, we don't have to defend the kingdom anymore, there's no more enemies, we'll be okay? I hope you said no. Once these warriors gained victory, it was all the more reason for them to continue to work hard, to continue to train, because they knew that the enemy was brewing. They were still trying to take over the kingdom. In the same way with us, when we feel like we've attained victory in our Christian walk, when we feel like everything is going well, we have to be prepared nonetheless. Because once we gain that victory, the devil is going to try so much harder to bring us down. The stronger you are with God, the more the devil's going to work hard. But don't worry, because with this, we have to continue to repeat this process. We have to continue to learn more about God and his values, and we have to continue to learn and to walk with him. If at some point you start to feel stagnant, if at some point you feel like you're already at the peak of your Christian walk, start the process over again. It's like marriage, you know? It's like relationships. If you feel like you've learned everything you know about your spouse, no, you gotta keep going. You gotta keep learning every day, because that's essentially what your relationship with God is. You have to learn more about him each and every day so your relationship can grow even more. And the overarching theme of everything is to remember. In these verses, we can see that who brought the victory? It wasn't the warriors, it was God. God brought about a great victory that day. So despite our own efforts, despite our own successes, despite everything we've done to get to this point, we have to remember that it's not us, but it's only God that brought us to where we are today. So remember that we are fighting a spiritual battle. We have to utilize those spiritual weapons. We have to be willing and able to take a stand, even when it feels like we're alone. We have to stick to our sword. We have to stick to prayer. And we have to be able to be faithful in our field and defend the defenseless. And when all is said and done, remember, family, that it's not us, but it's only God that brings the victory. So my last question for everyone here today is, what kind of warrior will you be?
As a response to what we have learned today, let us all rise and sing with our mighty voices, Mighty to Save. Thank you.
passion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save.
Father God, you are mighty to save. God, we know that the devil is always going to try to bring us down. He's going to try to interrupt our walk with you. But God, we know that as long as we stay by your side, as long as we stay with you, we know that everything is possible. I ask that you please be with us today as we go from this place. Help us to put our legs on these lessons and apply it to every day, to everyone we meet. We love you, God, and we can't wait to see you. Amen.